Hello, everyone. Good morning. Thank you for being with us. I see it's 10 p.m., 10 a.m. Luckily, not 10 p.m., 10 a.m. Let's get started with this next already fifth HPE update session from this month at Tech Data. Today, we're going to talk about Aruba Central. I'm not going to do it all by myself. I am quite happy that we found some time free in the agenda of Ken van Kampenhout, who is doing technical enablement at HPE Aruba here in Belgium and is supporting us today. So what's he gonna do? Well, he will explain in a minute by himself. He will give you a complete introduction of what is Central, what are the new latest things in there, and there will be also a demo. So there will be quite some interactivity. Meanwhile, I will stay here in the session as well to take a look at the Q&A, because yes, we will plan some Q&A time as well. So if you have any questions, please let us know. And otherwise, at the end of the session as well, we will free up some time to answer the questions that are there. I still see people connecting. Thank you for being with us. Hey, Ken, are you there? Can you hear me?
I can hear you loud and clear, Bart. I hope it's the same for you.
Yes, I can hear you too. So I'm gonna stop sharing my screen. So I'm gonna give you the show floor. It's all yours. And let us know what we need to know about HPE Aruba Central.
Okay.
Thank you.
See you.
Yes, I can see your screen. Yes.
You can see the slides, right?
Yes, I can see the slides, yes.
Okay. Okay, so first I would like to thank you, Bart, and the Tech Data team for the opportunity to discuss Aruba Central and our vision on single pane of glass network management. For the people who joined us for the last Aruba session, we had a discussion then on Aruba ESP, so our Edge Services platform. Probably you all remember that the ESP platform is an architecture, and that one of the cornerstones and the foundations for our architecture is, of course, Aruba Central, our cloud-native single pane of glass management tool. So what's on the agenda for today? I've got, let's say, four blocks in the presentation. First, I would like to start with an introduction and present what we see as the evolution of network management nowadays. Secondly, I would like to use some slides to give you a broader overview of what is Aruba Central, how it's built, what's the vision behind it. To continue with some key differentiators of Aruba Central, and to finalize my part of today's session with a short walkthrough demonstration of Aruba Central. Should there be questions, don't hesitate to ask them in the, I believe there's a Q&A opened up.
Yes, that's correct, yes.
Yeah, so at the end of the session, we can walk through the questions. Okay, so let's get into it. Where is it all about? So in the past, we architected our networks to support a cloud-centric compute model, which means we held great compute power in central locations like the cloud or centralized data centers. And all the connectivity, I should take my pointer, and all the devices in the edge were connected towards these centralized data centers. And all of the devices, of course, have local compute power, but the main data is oriented in the cloud, which is basically just a bunch of centralized data centers. Can be cloud, can be corporate data center. So this is an era which we call the cloud and mobility data, because it was all about facilitating mobility for the end users. For those of you who know us as being Aruba, we're all about facilitating mobility. Mobility for both wired and wireless users, and making sure they get the correct access rights and the correct processing power, the correct access to data, to resources, wherever they are positioned, whether it's in the office, on a remote location, that should not really matter. But Unlike the cloud, the edge is the exact opposite. The edge is highly distributed and is in all places where we live, work, and play. The edge is the result of the growing amount of IoT devices and OT technology, so industrialized technology. Think about for production companies, PLCs, production lines, all these sorts of things. So all these IoT and OT objects generate massive amounts of data, which in a lot of cases cannot be moved towards the cloud. A reason might be that the latency is a crucial component. For instance, if you have a production line and it's a fully automated production line and a sensor detects something, if we have to send the data being observed by the sensor to the cloud in order to, let's say, process the data over there and then execute a change in the local area, then probably it will be too late and the production line will be, stopped or halted, or there will be a lot of waste production or something like that. So some data components will always need to be processed at the edge because it's simply otherwise too slow or for compliance reasons. So this is why today we speak about the intelligent edge era. Of course, there is still a centralized component in data centers and stuff like that. That's why we're speaking from a move from edge to cloud. So the edge is becoming more and more important, and data in a second thing is being offloaded to the cloud, let's say. So this brings some networking challenges at the edge. All of these numbers on the slides, of course, are funded by some consultancy firms. So main challenges on the edge today is that a lot of the networks today are still built in silos. People have one solution for the corporate LAN, local area wired network, another solution for the local wireless network, possibly another solution for network access control, so another security stack. Even maybe another solution for software-defined one. So all of these different building blocks, let's say, all have their own management tools just to manage the environment, and then we're not talking about troubleshooting or something like that. When we go to troubleshooting, then typically we see that 70% of the time spent on managing the network is basically keeping the lights on. There are too much legacy tools when there are issues people use, things like network mappers, like Wireshark and all kind of legacy tools in order to pinpoint the issue and hopefully correctly identify it. So all these legacy tools and these different stacks also mean that there are more and more security threats. We all know that, we all know about crypto lockers, or we all know about malware which comes into the company being brought in with a let's say a laptop which has been used at home or things like that. So yeah, that's definitely a threat. Seamless access for the hybrid workforce. Of course, this is a very important thing today because the workforce, given the COVID-19 pandemic, of course, is becoming more and more hybrid. Not all people are based in the office. Practically everybody is working at home. Sometimes they come into the office, sometimes they work at home. So we need to be very flexible about that. So everybody is still thinking about how can we best facilitate this change. And of course, another one, and that's also not very remarkable, is of course that the IT budgets are constantly under pressure. Definitely when the, let's say when the company's business is business result is not going great, let's say it that way. So next thing basically is that despite all these challenges, we see that there is a massive amount being spent on cloud-based networking. According to IDC, there's up to 10 billion, which is going to be spent on cloud-based networking by 2022. Of course, this number is highly being influenced by the adoption rate of SD1. We see massive adoption rates for SD1, where we see that up to 42% of companies has already migrated this one solution to an SD1 driven solution, or is in the process of evaluating SD1. So that's a main driver for cloud-based networking, as a lot of SD1 solutions are basically using cloud-based management stack. Another important change is that we see that there is a very strong adoption of artificial intelligence or machine-based learning techniques inside the networks. I think it's not a surprise that also Aruba Central incorporates quite some artificial intelligence and machine learning techniques. According to an internal study of Aruba, IT leaders even think about increasing their spending in cloud-based networking and artificial intelligence due to the pandemic. This largely has to do with the fact that the environment is becoming more and more distributed, and people are searching for automation inside the network management and the tooling sets. So we see this as a very strong reason to increase, let's say, spending in cloud networking and artificial intelligence. Okay, so what is Aruba Central? Aruba Central is our cloud-based networking solution, and it's engineered to address all the challenges and trends I just briefly discussed. Aruba Central tries to break down the different networking silos, as it's a unified management and operations tool, so it works across all the different layers of the infrastructure, whether it has to do about managing wireless, managing wired networks, managing an SD1 solution, incorporating security. So all of these can be managed and incorporated from Aruba Central. Also, there are quite some artificial intelligence and machine-based learning techniques inside Aruba Central. I'll briefly touch on some of them. For instance, Central has the possibility to use artificial intelligence algorithms and provide configuration optimizations. There are also unsupervised machine-based learning techniques to, let's say, cluster different sorts of clients. So all these logic is also incorporated inside Aruba Central. Of course, the goal is to solve issues before they have a business impact on the environment. Of course, we haven't forgotten the classical monitoring capabilities to be able to monitor, let's say, the infrastructure. Maybe something also important: by default, Central comes as a SaaS solution, which basically means that we, as being Aruba, host Central in a public cloud solution, and that there is a subscription for the customer in order to be able to manage his infrastructure in Aruba Central. For the larger corporations, and then we're definitely today speaking about the very large corporations, we have the possibility of running Central in an on-premise stack. However, being deployed in an on-premise stack, we lose some of the artificial intelligence, because with porting everything to a local data center or local processing, we lose the scalability of the cloud. The cloud always offers more processing power, and we lose the automation of training the models, let's say, based on the data. Then another one, last but not least, is that we are also able to package Central in a full managed service. Then it's being called GreenLake for Aruba, or Aruba GreenLake, what's in the name? But that's also a solution to have the full stack, so management, Central, and devices managed by us, being Aruba. Okay, let's continue. So some more specifics. So what we try to do with Central is, as I said earlier, most networking management is still manual. We see that the change windows within, the maintenance windows within companies are shrinking, and we try to automate as much as possible. So we try to focus Central on a, complete scale of network management, and we have day zero operations, onboarding of devices, zero touch provisioning, all things like that. And then, of course, we have the continuous change of doing the move, add, and changes in the environment. So on day zero, it's good to know that Central hosts a complete zero-touch provisioning solution. It's really easy in the sense that once a device is being added to Central and it's placed in the correct group, it automatically receives its configuration from the cloud. And in that way, it's really true zero-touch provisioning. In an ideal world, the device even is capable of automatically showing up in the client's environment. So no need to type in the serial numbers or MAC addresses to add the device to the environment. Of course, this is based on our internal SAP system and the cooperation we have with our distributors to map the equipment on a certain customer ID. Should that chain somewhere be broken, no fear. There is still a mobile app solution to scan the barcodes, let's say, on the equipment and to add them in Central like this. So once the environment is provisioned, we are in the classical, network management time. And then there are plenty of solutions inside Central. There's the multi-edit capability coming up. For those of you who know NetEdit, NetEdit is a multi-switch interactive CLI template-based editor. So that's one way to manage your switching, for instance. You could do it pure on a GUI basis. For wireless, the same applies basically. You could manage your environments by templating or by using a GUI. If we go to the next gen of architecture, we will even have the possibility of doing full live upgrades of the on-site environment being triggered by Aruba Central. So we continue the, wireless service even during the maintenance window. Also important and very important and increasing in importance today is the possibility interaction with third-party platforms. So Central offers the possibility of both working with a fully documented API or to use webhooks in order to communicate, with third-party tooling. And in this way, for instance, automatically create tickets in an IT service management tool when Central basically creates notices an alert. So that are, of course, possibilities inside the platform. I have a slide specifically lined up for artificial intelligence, as it's one of the key topics today, key discussion topics today. So basically, Aruba Central offers artificial intelligence on different levels. We have AI Insights. AI Insights is the module basically that offers configuration optimization suggestions based on peer benchmarking and machine-based models. We are not automatically enforcing those suggestions because basically we want the network operator or the network manager to still be the the guy in control. We don't want to give control away to the optimization. The network manager should still be in control. Then we have two other this is based on peer benchmarking, which means basically that all data is being anonymized. We build models and we benchmark your configuration and your performance to the model. Then we have two other things. We have AI Assist. AI assist is actually a way of helping you with support issues and stuff like that. With AI assist, we basically follow a recipe. For instance, a certain kind of error has been detected in the environment, and then we collect the logs in an automated way, and we pre-format them basically to be shared with Aruba Tech. So ticket creation and data collection becomes more and more easy. Then another one is AI search, which basically means that you could type in natural language inside the search bar, for instance, where is client Ken's laptop, for instance. And then the system automatically is going to pinpoint my laptop as being and show where we can find it in the environment. So basically, to which SSID am I connected? What does the system know about my laptop? Things like that. So there is a statement over here which says up to 25% capacity increase. It's a real life example. For a retail chain, with AI insights, we detected that there is a lot of communication or a lot of, let's say, airtime being occupied by the pulling of mobile devices which are located outside the store. And then AI Insights actually suggested to adjust the single to noise probe threshold. I know it's a bit technical, but basically the system decides then to not respond when there is too much noise on this probing. And by doing that and not responding, we had up to 25% capacity increase inside the retail stores. So just by, let's say, blocking out people who are on the street or on the parking lot. So that's a very specific case where we got to optimize, let's say, the environment based on artificial intelligence. So some other value add key topping. Talking points, user experience insight. User experience insight is actually, let's say, a next generation way of monitoring the application performance for the network administrator. A lot of solutions, of course, offer monitoring of the hardware platforms, but always it is monitoring from an infrastructure point of view, which means we monitor parameters like the CPU, the consumed memory, possibly the analysis of the wireless spectrum. We see whether the wired bandwidth is saturated, yes or no, all these sort of things. But it's never the true vision from the true experience from the client. In order to really be able to capture the client's experience, we have to introduce a physical sensor in the environment. This physical sensor will then pull the client's applications just as it was a real, a client, a laptop or a smart device inside the customer's environment. There are some applications being predefined. The user can define their own applications to be pulled, or they can record an interaction in a browser and keep on playing this 24/7. Today we're at the first iteration of user experience insight, and I'm going to show this also in the demo, which means that when we have the site pop-up, basically we can immediately see whether the status of this site is good or bad. If we would drill down, sorry to say, but that's not really part of this demonstration. If we go in and drill down, then we go back to the classical user experience insight interface for now, because it's our vision and it's our goal, of course, to fully integrate user experience insight into Aruba Central. Another add-on is the ClearPulse device insight. ClearPulse device insight actually works with a local collector, so a collector appliance inside the customer's environment, where we're going to duplicate a lot of client data towards this collector in order to really know which devices are on the network. So the collector collects all kinds of data from the network, and it offloads the metadata towards the cloud. And in the cloud, we'll be basically comparing signatures of all the devices we see in the network in order to, let's say, correctly map the device ID. Often this is just on a statical way, things like what's the MAC address, what are the DHCP options it uses to get to request a DHCP address, all sort of data like this. But with ClearPulse Device Insight, we go a lot further. We also analyze, as it's a deep packet inspection engine and a collector we put locally, we also analyze where is it connecting to, what sort of protocols does it use for its day-to-day communications, does it communicate a lot, the frequency, the sort of protocol, the type of data, all these sorts of things are also analyzed. And in this way, we are very successful in also classifying IoT-based devices and even OT-based devices. So all these sort of devices which cannot easily be identified by using radius based on Active Directory data, let's say. So that's the goal of ClearPulse Device Insight. And of course, we still have the deep packet inspection engine available in our instant portfolio or our wireless portfolio, which of course offers application visibility and also the possibility of having web content filtering. Okay, so if we tie this back into the ESP model, as most of you probably remember, it's about managing unified infrastructure. So all the different layers in the network, and whether it's data center, campus, whether it's the branch office or remote, we can manage all these from our central management tool by default hosted in a cloud environment. So zero trust security, there are different security levels, of course, in an environment. Central is built from scratch on with the idea of having multiple source of management users, which can have access rights on different types of devices. That's one point of it. Another point, of course, is the interaction we have with ClearPulse or interaction we have with third-party solutions for securing the or our own UTM solution for securing the SDA branch part of it. And then, of course, AI ops is all about artificial intelligence. So analyze and act. So that's basically the third, value inside Aruba Central. So all of these are always offered in an as-a-service model, which basically means that Central is always subscription-based. So if we continue, I have a short walkthrough demonstration lined up. So which means I'll have to stop this share and start sharing another screen.
Please. Hey Ken, maybe meanwhile, while you are changing screens indeed, and you were talking about that Central being a SaaS platform and so it's subscription based. I have a question in the Q&A that has something to do with it. Hi, I see that for the public cloud, AWS and Azure are listed. It was somewhere around slide 6. What about Google Cloud Platform?
Yeah, by default, we host everything in AWS. So so our instances as being HPE or Aruba are being hosted in AWS. Of course, we have partnerships with a lot of cloud companies, but if you connect to the central public cloud, then basically it's always going to be hosted in AWS for our region. I don't know by heart how the other regions or where the other regions are hosted, but the EU cluster is hosted in AWS.
Okay, thank you.
For the demonstration, by the way, I have to connect to a US hosted cluster. So might be some latency on that. Let's see, because it's an internal single sign-on system. Okay. Yes. Now I still have to share the application. Okay, so Bart, if everything works okay, then you should now all see my screen again.
I see Aruba Central select account.
Okay, great. So once you are logged in, you should know that the user could have multiple central accounts. So if you as a reseller would like to have access to different customer accounts at the same time, there are multiple ways of doing this, or you add your email address or login credentials basically at every customer. Be aware that this way is limited, and there's a very limited amount of accounts that we support in this way. And then you can choose the different accounts when you log in. Another way of course, doing things is making sure you have a separate account on every one of your customers. So over here, you see two accounts. I'm gonna select this one, which is just named Aruba. The other one is a specific account for MSP, so Managed Service Provider Demos, which is of course a little bit more complicated, let's say. Okay, then you will arrive on this screen, which is basically account home. The account home offers the possibility of going into the network applications window, which we will do later on, or to launch ClearPath Device Insights. And of course, over here, you have all kinds of, system-based things. You could add management users. You could change rights. You could manage your subscriptions. Import keys, import devices, make a single sign-on application, work with the API gateway, the webhooks, the subscription assignment, and which devices need a subscription. Maybe there are devices which you no longer want to manage, then you could reassign the subscription to other devices. All sorts of things like that are being done from this view. But the interesting part, of course, is the network operations app. So when we launch this, okay. So when we launch this, you will immediately see that it's a map, of course, and that it is contextual. So all the parameters on the side over here and on the top over here change based on this location. So right now we're on the global level, which means it's the top level of our environment. And then the environment is managed on two levels. It's managed on site, geographical sites, and on device groups. Device groups are being used to have the same configuration on all, all similar devices. So for instance, you could have multiple offices, but you still want to have the same edge switch configuration for all offices. Then you would add all the edge switches to a specific site, but also all of these switches will be added to a device group and they inherit the configuration from the device group. So that's the important thing to know. So over here, you see a map with different locations on. So as you can see immediately, we have a pop-up when we hover over a location. So for this specific site, we see that the user experience, so this is the first incorporation I discussed with user experience insight. So we see over here that there might be Wi-Fi issues and which can lead to a negative client experience. Other things we see over here is artificial intelligence insights. There is one critical and there are some major and minor ones. being detected for this specific site. We have 12 devices on the site which are online, 0 offline, 8 clients online, 1 offline client, and immediately we could drill down to the specific floor plan of this site. So that's for this site in specific. Let's stay on the global view for some additional time. You can see all the tabs over here. So all these tabs basically offer the global view on the environment. So we could go to the WLAN, so to the wide area network, help tab, where we could see if we drill down, or we could already see over here, there are 3 sites in this SD1 setup. One hub, 2 spoke sites. You could see the some stats on the links and the availability. That's not the focus area of our demonstration today, as we just are incorporating Silver Peak in our solution, let's say. I expect some change on this, so I don't want to focus too much on the SD1 site today. But it's interesting to know, of course, and that's what I want to show, that it's all being monitored and managed basically from the same interface. If we go to the global summary page, then it's important to notice that this, or to note that this is a demo environment. We could change the amount of data being observed to generate the graphs. So for this view, basically it's fine because we still have some data, but sometimes it's gonna say no data, and then I need to change basically the amount of time we observe the data for creating the views. So immediately some interesting graphs, you see some interesting graphs on the usage, the amount of bandwidth being consumed, the amount of clients in the environment, top clients by usage, the top APs by usage. We see the WLANs being listed up all on the summary page. If we drill down, then we see another page, or if we continue, we see another page on Wi-Fi connectivity. We see over here some critical parameters for the environment. We see that in 81% of the cases, everything goes fine for our environment on a global view. In 100% of the cases, the association goes fine. So, which means basically that we have very good wireless coverage and that our smart devices or clients are able to always connect to the AP itself. We see that the authentication goes good in 75% of all cases. That's not really a lot. And if we go and look at, have a quick look at the AI Insights widget we have over here, then immediately we see that there are a lot of 802.1x, so radius-based authentication failures in the environment and stuff like that. So that's an important thing to note already. In a few clicks, we see where the issues is being situated, let's say. So for DHCP, we see that everything is going fine. And for DNS, we also see that there are a high number of queries being rejected. So there might be an issue as well with our DNS. So over here, we also see some graphs, on these data, on this data. If we continue to the global AI insights tab, then I'm going to prolong this. Then we see a lot of, artificial intelligence suggestions coming up. One of these is, for example, here, clients experienced high latency while roaming. We immediately see that it's a Wi-Fi based issue. We see how much clients, both number and percentage, are impacted. The total amount of clients and the amount of, problems there are. If we, that's strange. Murphy is passing by. So we should be able to open up the insight. And then we see possible reasons being identified by the system. So we see that, for instance, some clients need to fully re-authenticate while they roam, why typically their session should move from one AP to the other. Of course, There is a remediation over here to just enable fast roaming, the standard, which is an IEEE standard. Sometimes the DHCP server is causing issues. Maybe the client needs to roam between different subnets. What we see as well, roaming between different bands. So clients moving from 2.4 gigahertz to the 5 gigahertz Wi-Fi band. Now, as you can see a lot of issues being detected on our demo environment over here. Also immediately we see the amount of sites which has been impacted, the amount of access points, the amount of clients, and the percentage of high latency rooms. Yeah, 0.5% might not seem a lot, but if you think about fast moving environments, for instance, logistical environments where people use scanners and things like that, then you know there's going to be a lot of roamings in an environment. So this is one example of an AI insight. We check the time. Maybe it's also interesting to check another one. For instance, over here, clients had DHCP server connection problems. Basically, we see the same view over here. We see some reasons being suggested based on the AI algorithms, some recommendations to fix the issues. We see that over here, about 80% of the issues is being caused by just having a server timeout. So maybe this is the most stringent thing to solve, let's say. Over here as well, we see the amount of sites being impacted, the amount of servers, the amount of access points, and the amount of clients. So all of these is actually based on what the system observes. So it's based on the data which flows from the equipment on site towards central, and then the peer benchmarking internally within central. Let me go back to the network health tab. Let me drill down to a specific site. So I'm going to take this SD branch demo site because it's today it's the most developed site inside our let's say corporate demo environment. So as you could see, I clicked on the site, and right now we see that the context level, so over here it changed from global to the site specifically SD branch demo. So now all my tabs over here and all my buttons over here, they also are going to display the content based for this level. So if I would click clients over here right now, then I only get to see the clients for this site. If I want to go back to the global view, I simply click here and click back on global. So in this way, it's critical to understand that Central works in this concept of navigation by, let's say, location or group, which has to be selected over here. And then you basically get all the parameters for your environment. Let me prolong the time here. So if we get some more data, then we see a summary of the statistics over here. Of course, we still see the location, amount of switches, AP, or gateways. And gateways is our renewed term for a controller. So a gateway is a universal term. It can be a wireless LAN gateway. It can be an SD-WAN gateway in the edge, or it can be a VPN concentrator based in a data center. So if we look at this view, again, we see some basic statistics on the site and the amount of clients, the bandwidth being consumed. We see a change log. So we have three levels, no changes, just a few changes and many changes. For instance, if I would click on this date, then you see it gets marked by the angular brackets. There has been a change on a reboot level, so a log detection. If I would click reboot log over here, then we basically get a view on who has initiated the reboot and what the exact date and time is. If I go to a config change and ask for the config log, then we see that over here, there has been a specific certificate being installed. So all of these things are being kept. I don't see an upgrade. All of these things are being kept inside Central. Here is the config initiation to Aruba Central. So all of these things has been captured inside the environment, and you can see, of course, all the level of detail you would like. Graph on down devices, some graphs on the CPU and temperature of the devices, and then, of course, some specific wireless graphs on the utilization and noise levels for both wireless bands. If I continue to the summary tab, then we have similar statistics like we had on the global view, not going further in that. Then the Wi-Fi connectivity tab, it's also going to be very similar. Right now, of course, we're polling the internal database of Central, and sometimes it takes a while because we're having US-based equipment, cluster and installation, but it always pops up. And over here again, we see more or less the same statistics, or actually all the same statistics as we discussed on the global view. Same is going to apply for the One Health tab, AI Insights tab. A new tab which arrives when we're at a specific site is the topology. So let's see the topology. The topology is being automatically generated, and it covers all the equipment which is tied to this specific site. So we see, for instance, the access points which are positioned in the site. We see we see a switch over here. So the access points are connected to a switch, which of course has a specific name, model number, and health status. Then we see that there are two SD branch gateways on this site, which are being connected with multiple lines towards the internet. Some MPLS lines, a LTE line, sort of 4G line, and a public internet line. And those are connected to the headend VPN concentrators in a data center. If you don't like a left to right topology, of course, you could reshuffle this into a top down topology if you would like. So all of these things also possible. And you could drill down or collapse parts of the topology. And if you would like to, you could go and click show details over here and go to the equipment itself. Then we have specific for the site, the floor plans. So over here, you see a mock-up floor plan for this specific site. You see that we could generate the heat maps. They can be toggled on or off with the buttons over here. We could also display the client locations. And you see, for instance, these blue dots over here, which visualize the client's location. Client's location is being determined on triangulation. So you should have at least three APs, as you see on the drawing over here on the map, to do the triangulation of the clients. What else can we do here? We have the client, the APs. We could view rogue access points as well, if you would like. So over here, we also see that there is a rogue AP in the environment with a specific MAC address. Or we could search on the map if we have a larger environment to track down specific access points or rogues on our environment. So we've now discussed most of the tops over here at the top, or at least the most relevant part. Let's go a little bit deeper and go down to a device, for instance. So if we go down to the device view, again, we see different tops. And so you see that the context always, the tops and the context always change depending on the level of management. So when we're on overview, we have different tops on the top. When we go to devices, of course, we get access points, switches, and gateways. So access points for APs present in this environment, all being on the same firmware version. So let's just click on one and see which kind of parameters we get. Immediately, you see the context over here. So the main context is changing. So right now, all our tops over here and all the information over here is related to this specific access point. So we arrive on a summary page again, which offers us some details for the device, AP model, country code, MAC address, serial number. So serial number, of course, you could read all of these yourself. You see the possibility of doing a LED blink. A LED blink can be critical to identify a certain component in the environment. And if you have an issue or you would like to replace an access point for some reason, then you could do a blink from the central and in that way be sure that you're replacing the correct access point on site. Also, some network-based parameters. Over here, you see that there is one Ethernet link connected, the other one is down. We could see the neighborship details. Let's click it, let's see what happens. So we see it is connected to the SD-WAN switch we just saw on the topology. We have the MAC address of the neighbor and we know it's connected on port 15 of the switch. Some radio parameters as well here. And we see the full data path of this access point. So we see that there are no clients connected on either of the radios. However, the AP is up, is connected to a switch. The switch is being connected to the SDA branch gateways. And then we have, of course, the second gateway also being there. The health status is fairly good. AI insights, again, over here, we get the insights then specifically for this AP. And so we can see the same things. And so we see over here, clients roamed excessively. And we see that two clients have been impacted with this issue for this access point. We could go to the floor plan and show the AP again on the map. So we immediately see that it's being shown on the same map as we saw earlier. And we see the site location. As you can see, it's in California. Then performance, we see the throughput and the amount of clients on the access point. And we could see some RF details as well. Channel utilization, the noise being detected, some statistic about frame drops, errors, retries, or the general quality of the channel, the RF channel. All of these parameters again on 2.4 and on 5 gigahertz. Okay, so if we go back to the client view, for instance, then we see on the site SD branch demo that there are 54 clients which have been detected on the site. Of course, they are not all connected at the same time. We have a limited amount of clients active. It's a demo environment, of course. Let's sort this, or let's just pick a client. Of course, you see here the table. Do notice that you could filter, you could sort, all kinds of things like that. I think you can even customize the columns. So all kinds of customizations possible over here. You see there are a lot of parameters. Or you could download just this table as a CSV, so for offline editing purposes. Let's take a client. So maybe also something interesting to note, there's an icon over here, which of course means it is the wired or a wireless client. Let's take a wireless client first. So what sort of parameters do we get from this client? If it's a fully authenticated client, we see the username as well. So we can capture this from the .1x interaction. If it's being using user-based authentication, if it's just doing device authentication, of course, then we don't see a username. We see the host name, type of client. And over here, you already see some more specific client details. So these are actually also captured from the DHCP request and the deep packet inspection engine we have inside our access points, let's say, inside the firewall of the APs. So we see some details on the client. We see how the client is connected to the network, which VLAN is it being ported to. So this client, when it's connected on the WLAN, will be guided out to the access point or will be bridged inside VLAN 116. It's being segmented on port-based tunnel. You see that it's tunneled. Some parameters on the connection. So the connection, it's using a 40 megahertz channel. Again, you have the possibility of blinking the LEDs. You see the throughput, which is generated by the specific client, the client health status. The client health status, by the way, is an aggregation of all kinds of different parameters. So yeah, some basic things like signal quality, retry frames, stuff like that. But there are also more complex parameters being included. So basically, if we see that the client's health is green, then it's all good. And there is usually no need to really drill down into the different parameters. Also over here, we see the client's data path, and the client is connected to a certain SSID, which is being broadcast in this case by the lobby AP. It's connected on the SSID on the lobby AP. The lobby AP is connected to a switch on port 13, and this switch actually, or the user, is being tunneled towards a gateway. So PBT, meaning port-based tunneling. Port-based tunneling, so it's the entire AP which is being tunneled because it's connected on a physical port. AI insights, also over here we can see the insights on the client. So remember that we just saw AI insights from the AP point of view, but over here we see the same insight from the client point of view. So when you know that the client experienced a specific issue, you could drill down to the client and see whether the AI has detected that the client has been impacted by a certain issue. Location, again, the possibility to add it on a map. Let's go back to the client's view and let's select a wired client. So for a wired client, very similar approach. We start by seeing the data path, client connected to the switch on a certain port. Using port-based tunnel, it's being concentrated to a gateway. Same thing more or less applies over here. We see some client data over here. We see a host name. We see a username. So it's using clearly MAC-based authentication because we see the MAC address as a host name. We see that it's a Windows OS on a VMware manufacturer. So probably it's a virtual machine running on a server to emulate a client in our environment. And then of course we see also the wire throughput, and we see it's being authenticated as a gateway. So it's basically over here in the demo environment, a Windows client, Windows OS being hosted on a VMware server. Again, same thing applies. Should there be AI insights observed, then they will be listed here. Apparently there are no wired AI insights observed for this client. So back to the side view for the clients. Maybe in the interest of time, let's move on to the applications view. So on the applications view, this is being mainly triggered by the APRF, for those of you who are familiar with Aruba. So APRF basically is the is a part of the deep packet inspection engine we have in our access point, so inside of the firewall possibilities of the AP. And based on certain techniques for unencrypted traffic, of course, it's easy to know where it's headed. For encrypted traffic, we use destination and some heuristics to determine really which type of traffic it is. So for instance, over here, we see that in this environment, so for this site, we see a lot of applications passing on the wireless network. We see that Salesforce as an application, which is of course also a SaaS system, generates 4.6 gigabytes of data, which accounts for about 32% of the data on the environment. We see statistics on the sent and received data. I think we could even expand this, yes, and then we have a graph. So that's for Salesforce. Do note that we go really into the detail because, for instance, you see over here apple.com, web traffic, a certain amount of data, but you also see Apple push notifications from the mobile app store, we see iCloud data, we see native app store data, so quite some differences being detected over here. So this is for the global environment. Didn't show you this when we had a client view. Let's maybe go back to a client. Don't know whether we will, what this client is, so let's investigate what it does. So we see apparently that this is a user client because we see some more things turning up. So over here, you see the specific data usage for a client. For this iPad over here, we see the specific amounts of data or specific applications it uses. We also have a website view over here, so we can see what sort of website it also visited. Some web classification, basically. There's a UCNC module as well, but I don't think there's a lot of calls being made on the demo environment. So yeah, unfortunately, no data to display over here, but do know that there is a UCNC module as well. So back to the side view demo. What else can we do? We could maybe show some alerts and events. So over here, we see all the alerts and events which should have been triggered in the environment. So basically it logs about everything. So for instance, you could see here that there is a certain timestamp where we detected a critical alert related to the authentication delay, which impacted more or which states more than 30% of the authentication attempt made in the last 30 minutes were delayed more than a second at the site as they branch demo. So clearly something's wrong over there. So all of these are actually detected and observed, let's say, inside the environment. So there's also a difference between alerts and events. So an event basically can lead to an alert when it's critical, but an event can also simply be can logs onto a device. So events are not necessarily always words to be called an alert. There's a lot of data over here, so I don't know how much time it's going to take to load. Yeah, let's not wait for that. Okay, it's popping up. So as I said, it's really being drilled down. We can see the client de-authenticating from the client. We see a tunnel state change, the peer reachability. So probably this means that, as you can see over here, we lose the tunnel towards the data center. A lot of stuff over here. You could do some filtering as well. So again, it takes a little bit of time. So as you can see, we could do filter. We could filter on a lot of categories as well. Okay. Unfortunately, as this is a corporate centralized demo environment, I do not have the rights to, let's say, change or alter the configuration. But just for your information, you would have a change icon. Wheel, let's say, a pont wheel, a sprocket, if that's the correct term in English, in order to alter the configuration of the specific type. We didn't show the switch, so let's go into that. So again, over here, we see this specific switch, we see the amount of clients, alerts, model, and so on, and we could drill down a little bit more. See details for the switch, which is the type of the switch, serial number, labels being added as an MP location and contact data, the network. So how is the switch connected to the network? It's the management interface, basically. Some statistics on the ports, the hardware, no data to display. Maybe there has been little data going over the switch. So if I change the time frame to 3 months, then we see some uplink data, and we see over here some usage of the switch. As you can see, it's not really being critically loaded. Again, we can see some more detailed statistics on the hardware, the amount of power supplies, the states of the fans, utilization of CPU. If the switch supports it, you could also read some temperatures over here. Power supplies, yeah, there's only one because I think it's an F model. So it's only a built-in CPU. Routing, you could see the routing table from over here. And then the AI insights, as we always discussed for the switch itself. Also interesting, from over here, we could also upgrade our switch firmware. Of course, I can't launch it as I don't have the rights, but you could see over here that we have a build version 10 running on the switch, and apparently there has been a build version 11 released, which is newer and which can be launched from here. Tools that might be interesting as well to show. So we can do also some basic network troubleshooting tools from here. So we could, from the switch or from, yeah, from the switch over here, because we already have the switch selected, we could do some testing. We could do some ping or trace routes. But more interesting personally, I think, is the command over here, where we could actually launch commands on the switch. We have to choose a category. Let's take something simple. Loop prevention. Let's show the Aruba loop protect. Port list all. So right now I'm going to run the command on the specific switch. So we're contacting, reaching out to the switch API based. It's not using CLI, because of course we are from central in a cloud, and from the cloud it's not really secure to use CLI configuration directly to the switch. So over here you can see the output of the command. So troubleshooting session started. The command has been that has been used is show loop protect all, and then of course we see the output of the command as when we would be on the when we would be on the switch itself. So we see it for all interfaces. So 28, so 24 interfaces and 4 uplink interfaces. Device check. I think that's from compliance checks. We don't have that configured. Let's go back to the global view and see where we missed something. I think we've covered most of the topics, actually. Do know that there's also the possibility of hosting a guest interface inside Central. And of course, there's also presence analytics. Let's go to the global view. That's more interesting. So we could also create a guest interface from Central, which means we host the guest landing page in the cloud, and that there is an interaction between the wireless AP and the cloud in order to provide guest access to the guest clients, of course. Bart, I don't know how far we are with the questions, honestly.
Well, definitely, I can confirm that during your demo, we got several questions popping up. So that's good. That means that it was a complete demo of Central, what it all can do. Let me take a look. Because you're close there, you were showing those applications. So how does it detect the applications? How does it recognize those applications? Is that on DNS level or is there some other intelligence?
Yeah, there are a lot of things being used. First, it's important to know that we have deep packet inspection engine inside of every access point. So all Aruba access points by default have a built-in deep packet inspection engine. So we can look to the destination, of course, of the frame, which is the most easiest way, which basically means the IP address. But we also take in parameters the URL, so the DNS, it's not really DNS, but we also take in account the URL. And with the packet inspection engine, if the content is not encrypted, of course, we can also analyze the payload of the packet. However, for encrypted packets, it uses predictive techniques in order to classify the traffic. So actually, it's some sort of artificial intelligence, let's say.
Okay, cool. Thanks. There's another question that was really in the beginning of the presentation, more about the multiple accounts that you could create, but also about multi-tenancy. So the question is there a possibility for one account to rule them all through, for instance, the central MSP oversight console?
Yes, of course. So the view of Central I presented today is the, let's say, customer view or single account view. Central has the possibility of offering a full managed service provider view where you have the, mother account managing multiple child accounts. So there the end customer could be, or typically is the child account, and the integrator is the mother account, and the mother account needs to assign licensing to the different child accounts. So technically that's feasible. The reason we're not going specifically inside of that is that it's a specific training and certification program towards our resellers. But technically seen, it's an option.
Okay, perfect. And then you showed us as well, indeed, the devices list where we could see the switches, the physical switches, the branch, connections, and of course the access points for the Wi-Fi access as well. So it's really a converged management of wired and wireless. But I have a question here, specifically, is Aruba Central Management for instant on devices free, or is there still a subscription needed for cloud management?
Well, there's a big difference between instant on and the enterprise portfolio, let's say. Instant on, it's always subscription free. It can be, but it's not managed by Central. It's managed by the instant on management suite, which consists of a web application and an application on the smartphones. So that's totally different portfolio, which is more oriented towards, let's say, the SMB, so the smaller companies. We typically say about 100 employees. So typically an instant on cluster, AP cluster, tops off at 25 APs, where for the normal cluster type, we go up to 100 plus APs. So big difference in portfolio. Long story short, instant on is not managed by Aruba Central, and on instant on, there are no subscriptions.
Okay, very good. Thank you very much. Meanwhile, I think that all the open questions are answered. So for all the people that are still connected, if there are any questions, feel free to use the Q&A windows, of course. Meanwhile, I want to make a little publicity for this Thursday. So in 2 days, we will have yet another update session on everything on Aruba outside Central, of course. So it will be a little bit more hardware focused. While today it was really software focused. And if we see maybe on Thursday that there are other questions coming in as well about indeed the Aruba Enterprise and then the instant on solution, well, maybe this could be a reason that maybe somewhere in the February or March timeframe that we will organize a specific session on Aruba Instant On as well. Well, now know that if you have any questions whatsoever about Instant On, know that at TakeData we have a demo environment with Instant On. So there we can show you also the wired and the wireless solutions of Instant On. It's the same, but it's indeed another platform. It's with an application on my smartphone. So, but know that also there, our team can help you with all these kind of questions, because if there is one thing that I wanna show you indeed is to finish up this presentation, unless there are other questions, we'll stay online for a few more minutes. And otherwise, I want to thank you for your time, of course. I show you now had our entire team. It's not that we're alone. We have a big HPE team that can help you with all these kind of questions on the hardware, on the software. Now for Central with the subscription-based licensing, also there are quite a lot of options, 1, 3, 5 year options and so on. So if you have any questions whatsoever, there's the email address, there's the phone number of the HPE team at TakeData. I want to thank you for your time. Stay safe, and maybe we'll see each other. There are still some spots if you're not registered yet. It's the same website called techdataevents.be. So go there. You can still subscribe for register for Thursday session. And otherwise, we'll stay in touch. And also the upcoming months, we guarantee that there will be more sessions about all exciting new stuff being launched at HPE. Ken, definitely thank you a lot for the presentation and the very expanded and interactive demo. Thank you very much. And see you soon. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Thank you as well, Bart. Maybe something to add. Do know that there's always the possibility of creating a free, but limited in time, Central demo account. So if you want to experiment, you're welcome. Just try it out. I'm sure you'll be found with all the possibilities the platform offers.
I can confirm that it works, because I'm using that one as well. So also in my environment, I'm using, I have Aruba Instant On and I have Aruba Central in parallel. So to play with this, it's really fascinating technology, all the things that you can see with it. And I can confirm that definitely the day of I bought a switch, I put in a power cable, I put in some network cables, and the network works. Unfortunately today I see too many questions coming in of, hey, the network is slow, what's happening, it's working, it's not working. Even my kids at home, hey, the Wi-Fi is bad. And then you can show them at least already that their PlayStation is updating and downloading a huge amount of gigabytes. Believe me, it makes my life a lot easier to tell them that it's not me that is using the network, but that they are using, maybe even abusing network. It's all about the visibility. It's all about the intelligence. And this is what I like about Central. You have seen a lot of those AI insights. There's a lot of intelligence in the platform, just like with servers and storage. Well, now I'm glad to see that also in the networking world, that intelligence is getting more and more in there, making it a smart or even smarter network environment. So I'm sure that there's yet much more to come. Perfect, thank you very much, Ken. So if there are any more questions whatsoever, we'll stay a few more minutes online.
But maybe another interesting point for everybody who's still online.
Yes.
Do know that we're continuously expanding Aruba Central. We have a lot of features still being lined up. We have a packed roadmap. So a lot of things to come in the near future.
Definitely. So this is a good reason to keep on organizing these kind of update sessions the upcoming months and year. Perfect. I see no more questions. Anyway, know that the Q&A is still open for a few minutes as long as people are being connected in the room. And once otherwise, again, thank you for being here. Yes.
Also from us, from Aruba, thanks for facilitating this. And I think it's a great opportunity to, let's say, carry out the message towards the broader audience.
That's why we are here, of course. Yes.